Hi everyone, welcome back. In this video series, I want to talk about neural networks. This video series will take maybe many videos, including. And why I want to talk about neural networks, because this is the fundamental of artificial intelligence and machine learning. And if we continue, if we start from the neural networks part, which is the starting part of many AI and machine learning parts, so it will be very good for us to continue, because also in computer vision, in other things, in many areas we are using widely the artificial intelligence and machine learning, and many libraries we are using, many tools we are using, including these concepts. But actually, as a fundamentally, we don't know about them, what they are in reality. So in this video series, I will just start with neural networks, and maybe we will continue on machine learning and artificial intelligence. But how I will continue? First of all, I will talk about introduction part, and then I will switch on the practice part with code part, and I will explain everything from the basement, from the basic. So also I will make many examples. I will make many examples so we can easily understand what I'm talking about. First of all, neural networks starting the this area maybe starting 1930s, but first of all, as a conceptually, the big step started introduced by Rosenblatt, which you see in the picture. This scientist started in 1958 about perceptron. He introduced perceptrons. What is a perceptron? We can make a similarity in our mind. For example, in human brains, we generally using this kind of neurons in the left side, and in mathematical model, if we want to model these neurons, it looks like in the right side. I don't want to talk about the detail now. Just as a mathematical model, as a schematically, this is looks like in the right side. So in each neuron in human mind does only one job. So also these circles, let's talk about circles now. These circles also does one job in mathematical side, which we want to make similarity to these neurons. Also, first of all, we will talk about single layer structures. Why we calling this single layer? Because with multilayer, we will talk about later. For example, this is a multilayer, just an example, this model. So this is a multilayer, but first of all, we will talk about the single layer. And single layer perceptrons only used for linearly separable distributions. So if we want to classify in any distribution, if non-linear, single layer structures, which is perceptron, will not work. But this is very important, because even we pass on the multilayer perceptrons, still we will use the conceptually the single layer structures, which is perceptron, we will use again. So we should very deeply learn what is perceptron and what actually it does. And I said linearly separable, this perceptrons use, first of all we will talk about that. And in right side you see there is a two type of classifications. In the first one there is moon and stars, and it's clearly can be seen it's easy to separate these two class with a one line. But in below there are circles and squares, and if whatever you do in this part, you can separate this class. In the left side also, simply we have two class in our examples on our things for now, for this concept, and we just try to find what these functions do at the end. We want to find all these functions, and in any distribution, in any distribution classes they give us, we will be able to separate with a line this with this distribution. So what is actually perceptron do? This is a simple, and this is a simple schematic, this is simple model of what's a single perceptron model. And in this one, first of all, we have input and bias. What is inputs? Inputs can be anything which you want to push your model. For example, this can be coordinates in this part. If we talk about this, can be x and y coordinates. This can be other things. Your input. This can be not only two, can be more. And bias also. For example, this bias. If you cancel this one, these lines always will be on the origin. But by putting this, also it can be switched to other parts. So because it cannot be always be on the origin, in some situations it should be changed. So this bias doing that job in practice. Also in we have some weights. We will talk about this later again. Input sum. Again, we will talk in next slides, and activation functions and output. This is just as a keyword, you should know these things. And this is our model just for showing. And this part is our perceptron, which includes input sum, activation function and output. These parts actually we calling in our model perceptron. This part just input and this just perceptron. We call this like that. The most important one in here, mathematical model. How we are calculating our model. So first of all, we will take our inputs, then it will make some calculations, and in output, for example, you putting let's back to here again, this circle you want to find. Let's say this circle in mathematics we can say 1 and this square is 0. So in this x-axis and y-axis our input, for example 1 and 2. You will put in this example, this is 1, this is 2, and at the end, if your target is circle, you will say this is 1. This is the desired, which you expecting. But in the calculation also you are expecting this should be 0. We will talk more detail later. So what are these mathematical model steps? This is very important because in the code part, in the next video I will talk about the code part. So in that one we can we will use these steps. So this is very important to understand. What are these steps actually? First of all, prepare the input and target data set. This will be a training because we can call this as a training. Why? We are giving some inputs and at the end we are expecting with our model, which we will decide everything, our weights, our everything's bias and others. At the end, we are expecting our model anymore, any data given later, and this model will calculate what's the desired, what's the expected output giving us. So this is a training. First of all, we should prepare our input, what input we have, what target. For example, this input and the target we wanna get this target, for example, 1 or 0 or any number you given. On the step 2 part, initialize the weights and bias. Since in the function, I'm not yet give, but as you can see, x1 and x2 you already know because these are your inputs. You will get this from your data set, from your tests, from your anything. You should already get these inputs. But how to get these w1 and w2? We cannot get that. So what we will do actually, also bias we don't know, we will give random numbers. You can start with 0, 0, 0, you can start with 1, any random numbers you can start, because at the end they will always change and they will optimize and they will back to, they will change to a better values, fixed values at the end. But for just initializing, you can give any random numbers to these weights and to this bias. And step 3, calculate the input sum, which is y. And now this inputs we know, and we know y weights, we know bias. And then bias also, you can generally people start with 1, but again we don't know bias. You can start any number. W3 you can start with any number. Then we know these things, and now we should calculate y. How to calculate y? This is a simple model how we are calculating y. x1 times w1 plus x2 times w this will be w2, sorry, and then bias times w3, and this will give us y. We know w's, all w's, we know bias, we know input, so we will calculate y. Then step 4, calculate the activation function. What is an activation function? In here I just put this, but this is not the only activation function. There are many activation functions. What's an activation function? I said many times activation functions. It defines how the weighted sum of the input is transformed into an output from a node or nodes in a layer of the network. This also cause of transformation is called also transfer function. And this function is not non-linear also, as you can see in here. There are many times, as I said, you can use any of them. This is generally up to, for example, after you really familiar with the activation functions, you will understand in which situation which one you should use. This is with according to your experiments later you will decide easily, I think. And in here, which is my favorite and works with many things, sigmoid function, I just take from this one. And since this is our sigmoid function, what we will do in this part, just our after we get y, we will take this, let me check again, this is actually minus z, I put here wrongly probably, not minus 1 but will be y. So this our activation functions, how we calculate this a part. Then decide the threshold. This threshold part also very important. After this activations, for example, we using this will be get the number from this and from this, between these two. This is generally 1, this is 0. So at the threshold in here, the logical threshold will be in the between them. This threshold also depends on the output you get at the end. This is again according to what you're getting at the end. For example, you can say, if you say 0.5, if bigger it's star, if you talk about this one, if small than 0.5 it's moon. You can think like that. This is the threshold. You will get some outputs after all calculations, then according to the by checking them, and you should decide the threshold value to separate which is star, which is moon, or which is square, or which is circle, like that. Then calculate the error. Why we are calculating error? Because backward to update our weights, we will talk later. How we calculating our error? Easy. What you are expecting, what you are getting. Target we already know, because in the beginning we said you should prepare your target dataset, because you should at the beginning know inputs, you should know expected targets, target values. So you know that for if you start from the first inputs, then this is the will be output target output of the first input. And then after this calculation, activation function output, you will get a result. And after that result, you should apply threshold. After threshold, you will get a value and you will put that result to here. Then you will calculate your what your error is. This is important because we will use this to update our weights. Why we should update our weights? Because we assigned them randomly. We don't know what should be there, what they should be. So we should update our tree weight. How we are updating? For example, for W1 times learning rate. What's learning rate? This is also another conceptual thing. For example, if you, this is the given between 0 and 1, this is a float number. So you can give this for it if you want it to learn not really quickly but more properly. You should put it close to 0. If you learned want it to learn quickly, but sometimes can be learning quickly not good, this is also according to the experiences you should decide later. This is simple learning rate. You should generally people giving between 0 and 1. This is a float number generally. 0.2 they suggesting generally to give. I'm also using 0.2, but it's not really important for now. Then error we already calculated, and x1 we already know. Now we know our new w1. But still this will not be true. What will happen? You will back to step 3 again, because you have other inputs also. You with one input, if you train, it's okay. It will be done and you can easily call. But you will of course have many inputs, and you should back to step 3. And with these W's, new W's, you should calculate again. Then you should come again here. These iterations you should do until your inputs finish. But in here there is a point. Even your inputs finish, it doesn't mean these W's are required. These are enough. These are get the right values. No, maybe you should restart your inputs from the first one to end again, and you should update these weights again. How many times you will do this? Again, this is up to experiences. It can be changeable. It is not fixed value. This also each things you trained, you can maybe calling it trained, these input values, it's called as epoch. Epoch, maybe I talk about in here, yeah, epoch. In each time these inputs are passing from your functions, from your model, I mean all inputs, for example, all inputs finished and you get your weights, and this is one epoch. And if you wanna reiteration of your inputs, then this is second epoch. For example, these epochs can be 10, 100, 10,000, can be many, but also can be in even 5 can be enough sometimes. This is again according to the what you expecting, what you want to do. There are some keywords also. This is probably last slide. Okay, what are the keywords? You already know maybe activation functions. In the other name is transfer functions, epoch we just talked, batch mode and online mode. These also conceptual words. Batch mode is how to say, for example, you want to train your data set. This can be you give all your data set. You have, for example, 10,000 data set, and you're giving all these things to your model and you are training it. This is batch mode, which is offline. But if your data set always changing, always new data coming, okay, in now, for example, you have 10 data, but 1 second later, one more data pair will come. So if you wanna update your weights, you wanna train your models with new data always, so this is online mode. It's always incrementally the inputs increasing, so this is the online mode. Perceptron, I think you already learned. We can think this is a neuron in our brains. We can make a similarity with our brain. And layer are in this model. This is a layer, for example. Also, this is a layer, input layer. This is also a layer. And learning rate, we talk little, we will talk more later. Learning and generalization, this is also very important concept. These are trade-off between each other, what they are. For example, we should talk now or not later maybe, but less little talk. You want to train this data, but if you many times iteration, also many times epoch to your model to train this data set, later when new data come, these lines can be difficult to fix itself. How to say, if you train much, it's not really good sometimes, because if you really really learn, try to push your model to learn much, then it will be memorizing anymore, not actually learning. You should stop learning in a limit. You should decide that. This is also there is not a formula how to stop, where to stop. There are some, but this is again up to your practices, up to your experiments. It can be changeable. And classification, you also know these are some keywords, and also presentation finished. This is a little longer maybe this video, but in the next video, this is just for first one. In the next video, we will make examples, a real examples. We will have a data set and we will train it, and we will see how it's working, how these steps are working in the code part. We will do it from the zero. Then this is just for single perceptron, just single layer structures, but later we will switch on the multi-layer, more complicated. Then we will continue on this way. Okay, this video a little longer, so sorry for this one, and see you in the next videos.